Good morning and welcome. It's good to share in worship this morning. If you're visiting with us today, we wish you an especially warm welcome. If you are interested in staying connected with our church, please email us at office@westwooducc.org. You'll also find information on our website, westwooducc.org, and can reach out to us there. Welcome again. Let us gather ourselves for worship with our centering song.
God, safeguard our bodies and minds, just as you safeguard our hearts and souls. Remind us to place ourselves in your hands, for there we shall find rest. There we shall find courage. There we shall find strength for the journey ahead. Show us again, O God, what is important, and let us shake off the dust of all that does not really matter. For you have a view that is longer than time, not only into the past, but into the future as well. And you never, never fail to lead us into life. Amen.
The scripture reading comes from us, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6, 1 through 13. He left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, brother of James and Jose and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense to him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. He went about among the villages teaching. He called 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and to not put on two tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. This ends the reading. May God add the blessing.
I think I've been kind of addicted to the news lately. Does this ever happen to you? I can't seem to stop checking my phone almost obsessively from the moment I wake up in the morning. Some part of that feels like there's a lot going on, and I want to be informed about what's happening in the world. There are, after all, earthquakes in Haiti, fighting in Afghanistan, climate change in the news again, forest fires, the likes of which we've never seen, and COVID, endless, endless news about COVID. So yes, of course I want to be informed. But for me anyway, there's another piece of that constant phone checking. There's some sort of belief in me that if I can just be informed, then I can be on top of what's happening in the world. And if I can be on top of what's happening in the world, then I can feel more in control of all of it, which is ridiculous because I don't have any sort of control over all of those things happening in the world. As I just said a moment ago, the ordination did not come with any sort of magic wand or crystal ball, nor yet a cape, Robin, not yet the cape. Maybe when I hit my 20th anniversary. But it is a lovely illusion, right? A lovely, lovely illusion to believe that if I can just know enough, if I can think through every potential pitfall or stumbling block or problem or challenge, then I will have overcome them all and can determine the outcome. I can have some agency over these impossible situations and how they play out. Of course, that's not actually what happens. Instead, I just find myself overwhelmed by the sheer amount of lousy situations in the world. Normally, when we read today's scripture, this text from Mark, we tend to focus on this message as a response to rejection. When people don't want to hear the gospel, Jesus says, shake the dust off your feet and move on. But today, I'm hearing shake the dust in a little bit different way. According to biblical scholar Chris Haslam, another meaning of this passage has to do with focusing on what matters most. What matters most? As Jesus sends the disciples to teach and to heal, he wants them to focus on what's really important and find what they can do about it rather than dwelling on what they can't. Haslam writes, because of the urgency of the mission and the need to trust in God, they are to subordinate material and physical concerns to the task of preaching as he does. They are not to waste time seeking better accommodation, nor on those who refuse to listen. Just move on. Do not waste time. Just move on. I'm captivated by this idea, probably because it's so difficult for me. I'm captivated by the idea that this text is not saying ignore those who disagree with you, but rather stay focused on what matters and what you can do about it. That when things don't go as planned or work as we wanted, there's a way to let that go so we can just move on. I read an article this week, an interview with the author of a new book on time management, 4,000 Weeks, Time Management for Mortals, by Oliver Berkman. Berkman's thesis is that people who live to age 80 get about 4,000 weeks in their lives, way less than anybody assumes when he asks them. The title struck me because I usually think of my life and my time in spans of weeks, much more so than days or hours or months or years. I think about what I have to do this week and what's coming next week and what was last week. It's 1 week from one sermon to the next. That's probably why I think that way. It's a week until school gets out. It's a week until school goes back. It's a week until Ash Wednesday. It's a week until Easter. It's a week until anything. Some weeks are slow, some weeks speed by. Sometimes I can't even recall how I spent most of my time 2 weeks ago, though it was all-consuming at the time, because whatever is present is all-consuming at the time. 4,000 weeks doesn't feel like very many to spend a whole lifetime, especially when the past 75 of them have not gone according to plan. Think about that. 75 feels like a bigger percentage of 4,000 than I would like for it to be. Oliver Berkman's idea about those 4,000 weeks is not that we need to come up with a million ways to squeeze more productivity into the time that we have. This makes him different from every other time management expert who's out there. While Berkman acknowledges that boosting our productivity will allow us to process more input, he also reminds us that we live in a world with an infinite number of inputs. Emails we could receive, demands that could be made, ambitions we could have for ourselves. Even if we get better at processing the inputs, he says, that usually just leads to receiving an increasing number of them. The faster we work, the more we have a reputation for working quickly, the more people will give us more work to do because they know that we work fast. So every time we try to get all the annoying stuff out of the way so that we can get to the important stuff, we just end up with more annoying stuff. This is a life-changing concept, my friends. Berkman says, getting better at moving through them is not going to get you to the end of them. There is no way to be on top of it all. Better to do the stuff that matters first, he says, then wait for it to be the right time to do it. Berkman's book and today's text from Mark make me think about the past 75 weeks in a slightly different manner. Of course it is and was right to protect ourselves and others. Of course it is and was right to put certain wants and even needs to the side for a time, to put some things on hold. But the past couple of weeks, I've been thinking about the cost of putting things on hold. And thinking about the fact that I haven't felt like I could go to the doctor in person. And that can't actually go on forever, right? It's clear now that COVID isn't just gonna magically disappear one day. And that we might not be able to wait for it to go away before we stop putting things on hold. We may have to find some way to live with it in our midst. We might need to find ways to live around it. We might have to acknowledge that there is no way to be 100% safe, just like there is no way to get all of the annoying things done in our lives. There will always be more. And maybe there's no way to wait until everything is fine, is normal, before we start to live again. Maybe we have to, as Riley's first grade teacher used to say, do the best we can and move on. Take all the appropriate precautions, but still decide to live. Last Sunday, the deacons and I met for our annual summer retreat, gathering outside with masks and distance, but in each other's physical presence for the first time in a year and a half. Usually, we use our summer retreat to do some planning for the year, big picture thinking, and mapping out themes and directions for worship. But this year, we needed something different. We needed to just come together and pray. We spent the entire retreat meditating and reflecting on a particular scripture, that passage of Matthew 11, in which Jesus talks about the things that are hidden from the wise but made known to children, the one in which the faithful are invited to come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. As you might imagine, there was a lot of reflection in our time together on the idea of coming to Jesus, and with the reminder to rest, and even with the acknowledgement that some things are made known only to the newest and freshest among us. Almost everything that was shared seemed to resonate around the circle. You could tell by the nodding heads. But one thing was said that I hadn't expected. Near the end of our time, one of the deacons said the scripture reminded him of the power of invitation and how invitations seem much more frightening than they did a year and a half ago. How there's this calculus in our heads about, do I feel safe? Could I go and do that? Is that okay? Is it outside? What's happening? What, you know, maybe I should stay home. And at the same time, as there's all that fear, he said there's also that sense that invitation is more necessary than it ever has been in his life. This deacon told us he wants to enter this coming season being more open to the invitations that come his way, setting aside fear to embrace the welcome when it presents itself. Undoubtedly, there's a range of comfort and discomfort among us when it comes to engaging in the world just now, when it comes to accepting invitations, going to events, sending kids to school, returning to offices, meeting friends for a meal. No matter the comfort or discomfort with risk, there is something to be said for shaking the dust off just now. There is something to be said for finding ways, any ways, of letting ourselves live again, whether in our homes or out in public. It's not even a matter of where we do or do not decide to go and what we do or do not decide to do. It's a matter of deciding to live. It's a matter of learning from all we've been through in the past 75 weeks. What we've learned about what really matters the most and what doesn't really matter much at all. It's a matter of choosing what matters first, before anything else. Deciding that there will always be emails to answer or news to read, but maybe I'd handle them better if I started each day with prayer. If I started to talk to God even before I open my eyes in the morning and sat still just for a minute to listen to see what God says. If I shook off the distractions and the endless need to control and put myself in the presence of peace, what would happen if I let the noise of the world recede so I could hear first the sound of the Spirit? Where do you need to shake the dust off right now? There's something in your life that some place where things aren't going as planned, some relationship where you need to let something go, some expectation you've carried longer that no longer fits, some assumption that isn't coming true, or just some place where you're feeling stuck and you want and need to move on. Is there something, anything, that's wasting your energy or wasting your time and keeping you from what actually means the most? What will you do with the next 75 weeks? What is it that would make them matter? Shake the dust from your feet, my friends. May God help us keep moving on. Amen. Feel free to hum along as our musicians sing for us, Found Tonight.
Tonight. They'll tell the story of tonight. they tell you. Raise a glass to all of us. Tomorrow there'll be more of us telling the story of tonight. They'll tell the story of tonight. All is new. It's only a matter of time. Even when the dark comes crashing through, when you need a friend to carry you, when you're broken on the ground, you will be found.
So let the sun come streaming in, 'cause you'll reach up and you'll rise again. If you only look around,
you will be found.
And when the children tell the story,
of shaking off the dust is that we're not always completely clear about what really matters and what mostly doesn't. Oftentimes it can be hard to tell the difference, especially in our own lives. One of the best ways to get a little perspective on that is to share our concerns with each other. Then together we can carry them to God, because there's usually somebody among us who's struggled with a similar trial. And when we don't know how to share our burdens with God, those who've traveled a similar path can lead the way. Then, when we found our way into God's heart and soul, we ourselves can turn and hold out a hand for those who come after us. Let us join our hearts together as we continue in prayer. Holy One, hold us close and send us forth, that wherever we go, you may bring your healing, you may bring your grace. We pray that it will flow through us, that it will heal us, that it will heal those around us, that it will heal this hurting, paining world. God, we pray that you will be with those who suffer and give them strength and courage and whatever they need to keep going. We pray that you will be with those of us who rejoice, and may that joy spread to all people in all places. Come, God, and bring your Spirit in us, with us, and through us, now and always, we pray. Amen. For all the petitions that have been shared, we know that others are still quiet in our hearts. Let us take a moment now to lift them up silently as we rest in God's care.
We join now in praying an alternate version of the Lord's Prayer, written by Francis McNab and displayed on your screen. Good caring presence within us, around us, and above us, hold us in a sense of mystery and wonder. Let the fullness of your goodness be within us and around us. Let all the world know your ways of caring and generosity. May we find we have all we need to meet each day without undue anxiety. Overlook our many stupidities, and help us to release everyone from their stupidities. May we all know that we are accepted. Strengthen us that we will reach out to the best, always with the faith to rise above the ugly realities of our existence. And we celebrate the gifts you have given us, the rich kingdom of life's possibilities, the power to do good and the triumphs of good, and the moments when we have seen the glory and wonder of everything. You are life's richness. You are life's power. You are life's ultimate meaning. Amen.
How can we offer anything in a world that seems only takeaway? War, disease, loved ones. Offering is defined as the act of one who offers something offered, especially a sacrifice offered as a part of worship and a contribution to the support of a church. Offering is also a choice. We can choose to give our time to help a charity like Safe Parking. We can pick the places we will support financially, and we can sacrifice our needs above others. I've been giving to the International Rescue Committee over the last couple of years. IRC helps people to survive, recover, and rebuild their lives. With the crisis unfolding in Afghanistan, I felt powerless, but then it hit me. I could support the Afghan people by donating some money. The IRC has been working in Afghanistan for over 30 years and remains committed to supporting people caught in this crisis. So if you're feeling low and maybe about, you know, maybe think about choosing to help someone else. Our morning offering will now begin. Erin will put the links to the Venko in the chat, or if you'd like to send it the old-fashioned way, you can send a check to 1989 Westwood Boulevard, LA, California, 90025. Our musicians will sing Let River Run.
As we prepare for the benediction, I invite you to hold your hands up to the edges of your Zoom box or toward those around you in the sanctuary. We see that we are together and remember we are one. People of God, go into the world and start with what matters. Trust that the rest will follow. Amen.